Hi guys, and welcome back for a new video. Today I'm going to show you the management interface for the TP-Link Archer C3200 router. As the name puts it, this is an AC 3200 model. It's a 3-band model. It has two 5.0 gigahertz and 2.4 gigahertz. You have a total bandwidth of 3200 megabits per second. This is obtained by combining two 5 gigahertz 1300 megabits per second and 2.4 gigahertz 600 megabits per second. Okay, so this is the welcome screen. I am going to log in right now. So this is the default admin, and this is the quick setup menu. Okay, so first of all, it requires us to change the username and the login password. Okay, I'm going to put to let admin, and let's see, maybe. Okay, so I put all the numbers from 1 to 9. You see here we have a low security warning. And let's confirm it. Okay, so now we have to log in again. Okay, and now we can access the quick setup menu. Okay, the first step is to select your area for the time settings. Then you can choose your internet connection type. We also have an auto detect function. The dynamic IP is the most basic and the most common one. Then you have the static IP and the PPPoE and two other settings as well. Okay, I'm going to use the dynamic IP because this is what I'm using. Okay, I'm not cloning my MAC address because I don't need to. My provider doesn't require me to provide him my MAC address. Okay. And next we have to set the wireless interfaces. So we have the wireless 2.5 gigahertz. We can enable or disable it, and okay, let's have it, let's rename it like this. Okay, and let's select a password. Okay, then the first 5 gigahertz network. And the second 5 gigahertz network. Okay, we're ready to go to the next step. And here we have the summary. Okay, so this is the time zone, the internet connection type, and the wireless settings. And that's basically all you can do in the quick setup screen. Okay, so we have completed the quick setup process and now we are ready to test the internet connection. Like this. Okay, so we we are getting a smiley and a success message. Okay, and now let's press finish. Good. We moved on to the basic tab, as you can see right here. So, and the first part is the network map. So we can see we have the internet connection enabled and functional here, and a few more details below. So the status and the IP address and the DNS server and the gateway and so on. Then we can click the router icon and we get a few info about the wireless networks, as you can see right here. So as you can see, we have guest networks for both the 5 GHz interfaces and for the 2.4 GHz interface. But by default, they are disabled, so the status is off. So you get the same info if you press the wireless icons right here. Also, there's a question mark. Well, this is the help menu. So if you don't if there's something you don't understand when you want to set up your router, you can simply press this question mark and you get some help. Next, you see we have some sort of a tree here. So there's the internet, next is the router, and below we have the possible connections. Right now, there aren't any wireless clients, but if there were, they would have shown up right here. Like this wired client. This is the PC I'm using right now. I don't have a printer connected. I'm never using the print server in my router because my printer has wireless functionality, so I don't need this tool. And next, there's the USB disk section. I have a USB flash drive connected right now, so this is what it shows here. Next, there's the internet step. So basically, you can select the internet connection type. As I showed you, I chose dynamic IP, but you can go for PPPoE and you have different settings for that, or static IP and PPPTP like this, or L2TP. I'm going to switch back to dynamic. Then there's the wireless section, which is basically the same as before. We also get the hide SSID function for each radio. The USB settings. So as you can see, it shows my USB flash drive. Shows up right here, and we have a safely remove function, and okay, so I just deactivated my drive, and now I'm reactivating it back. I can choose to have a media server using this drive. And I can choose a name for it. By default, it is called Archer C3200, which is actually the name of the router. And I can choose to share all for the all folders, which is the default setting, or I can add folders. Maybe I don't want to share everything. Okay. The share name cannot be blank. Okay. Oh, browse. Sorry. So this is not quite a friendly setting. Let's share this one. And maybe this one. No. So you have to choose one at a time, like this. But this won't go away, apparently. So. Well, so this is not working as it should. Okay, this time is much better. Okay, folder name, let's say test. Okay, and we can enable or disable authentication, and we can enable or disable media sharing as well, and write access. Okay. And if you want to add more, you can do just that, but I think one is enough for now. You can also edit it at any time. Or, as I told you before, you can, let's quit. You can share all available folders, and you can enable or disable authentication as well. Next, there's the print server. So, as I told you, I don't have a printer connected to this router at this point, and that is why I'm going to just disable the print server because I don't need it like this. You see this the changes takes place very quickly, so it's basically in real time. Then we have the parental controls tool. Okay, let's enable it. And we can whitelist or blacklist different stuff. Let's add a keyword. I don't know, like adult, for example. Okay, and maybe 66 or like this. So all these are blacklisted at this point. Also, we can choose the devices we want to apply this to, and let's say child's computer. Okay, and maybe we want to have some schedule. Okay, like this. Okay. So it wants to be sure I really want to add this device under control because this is the device I'm using right now. So no, I don't want to do this. Okay, and I'm going to disable the parental controls right now. and remove the keywords. Okay, next we have the guest network, and we can choose on which radio interface to enable it. Usually I'm doing this only for the 2.4 gigahertz, because if there's someone coming to visit me or something like that, it won't need the 5 gigahertz, because people don't come to my place to download torrents or stuff like that. Okay, and let's say test underscore guest. Okay, and we can set or not set security password, and let's say guest like this. Okay, and if I want, I can allow guests to see each other, and I can also allow them to access my local network. But no, I don't want to allow them to see my my network. Save. Okay. Wow. So you cannot set a password with less than 8 characters. Then I'm going to do just this. Guest underscore 2.4. Save. Well, that was quick. And let's move to advanced tab. So this is where you are going to find all the settings you probably need if you buy this router. So basically the first step is the status part, and you can see here we have the internet status. And for IPv4 and IPv6, but as you can see, there's only IPv4. Then we have the wireless status. This is a bit more comprehensive than before in the basic tab. So it also shows you the channel. The 2.4 gigahertz is running on channel 4 right now, but this is automatically chosen, and the channel width, the bandwidth is also automatically chosen. Then the first gigahertz, the first 5 gigahertz network, it is by default set on 80 megahertz, and the channel is by default manually selected 36. And last but not least, the second 5 gigahertz network, it is running on channel 100 and again on 80 megahertz. Next we have the infos for LAN here. So the MAC, the IP address, and the mask, and the DHCP status. IPv6, I'm not using it. And then there's the 2.4 gigahertz, the guest network, sorry. The 2.4 gigahertz is the first one, the one that I enabled and already set up. And the other two are disabled, as you can see. Let's move on to network. We can set up the WAN interface again right here. So, but this time we are getting more tools, so we can set up more things. Okay, let's put it back to dynamic IP. Next, there's the LAN setting for the local area network. So we can choose the local area network IP and the subnet mask. And there's IPTV support as well. We have a few available modes or a custom one. And you can choose the functionality for each local area network port on your router. So, like this. Okay. Next, there's the DHCP server, which is by default enabled. And it will begin with no matter what IP address it is using, it will start the pool with 100 and end it with 199. But of course, you can change this if you want to. Also, you can manually set up your desired DNS. Next, we have some info about the client list here. So there's only one client right now. We also can reserve some address like this. So I'm putting the MAC address and reserved IP and some short description for the device. And then every time the device will get the same IP. I'm usually doing this for my network area storage because I have the shared drives mounted in all my PC in Windows, and I want it to be available to be every time available on the same IP. And then there's the condition pool as well. There's also some dynamic DNS functionality. So you can use DIN DNS or no IP. Or you can, okay. This you can quickly sign up for dynamic DNS. You can set the advanced routing rules. So destination IP, subnet mask, gateway, interface, and of course enabled or disabled. And you can also see the system routing table. Next, there's some VPN functionality, but unfortunately there's only the IPsec. So as you can see, there's no OpenVPN support. And let's move on to wireless. There's a smart connect function. This basically aggregates all your wireless networks. And when you want to connect a device to your router, you won't be able to choose 2.4 or 5 gigahertz. You will only be able to see one SSID, and because the router will only show one SSID, and the router will automatically choose to connect your device on 2.4 or 5 gigahertz. I'm not doing this because I don't usually trust this kind of automatization, to be honest. So these are the available settings. You saw some of them before, but now we can choose the security mode. Here we can go for VPA or auto, and we are not forced to use the AES encryption, although this is the best. And then you can change the password, you can change the wireless mode, you can manually select the desired channel, and you can select the channel width like this. And there's also a setting for transmit power, but I don't think there's anybody that would want to go for anything but high. And let's save our settings. Next, the things look pretty similar for the 5 gigahertz networks, as you can see. So there's the DSS ID, the security mode, security version, and the encryption mode. So if I go for auto here, I can also choose auto for encryption. Then there's the password, the wireless mode, the desired channel, and the bandwidth of the channel. Okay. And again, the transmit power. And it's basically the same for the second gigahertz network, except for the channel, because now we are going to use the upper channels, and as you can see, there's quite a big offer here. Oh, there are plenty of channels for you to choose from. Okay, so this is a DFS channel. Basically, if there are some other devices, let's call them devices in your area that are using this frequency, they will force your router to stop using this radio interface, so that it won't interfere with them. So maybe if you are located near a military base or something, you will not be able to use the second 5 gigahertz interface. Okay, let's save this one as well. Next, there's the VPS option. So you can use PIN code or the push button. Personally, I don't trust either one of these two, so I usually disable the VPS functionality, because I don't find it that difficult to remember my wireless password. So I'm disabling the router pin, but as you can see, there's no option here to disable the push button. Not here anyway. Then we can do some filtering using MAC addresses. Okay, so this is a bit slower. Okay, so that's it. And we can block wireless access from certain devices or allow wireless access for certain devices. Like this. And we can add devices right here. And we only have to know the MAC address and type a short description and hit OK. And that's it. Okay, I'm going to disable this because I don't need to block or enable certain MAC addresses. There are no strangers close enough to my router to be able to access my wireless network. Then you can set a schedule for the wireless functionality, because maybe you don't want your wireless running at night, and we can, let's say, from 7 to midnight, like this. Okay, and then we can just press save. But I'm going to disable this right now. And then we have some statistics. But as I told you, I don't have any wireless devices connected right now. So there are, as a result, no statistics available. Next, there's the guest network. Okay. So it tells me that wireless function is disabled. No? Oh, yeah. Okay. Save. Back to guest network. And as you can see, these are the settings I did before. And the other two are disabled. We have some settings for the net forwarding right here for different protocols, and we can set up some virtual servers. I'm usually doing this for my Plex server and for my Western Digital MyCloud network area storage device. So basically you just punch in the service name, the external port, the internal IP, the internal port, and the protocol you want to use, or you can choose to enable for all available protocols. And there are also some predefined applications right here. Then there's the port triggering functionality. With the available preset applications. The demilitarized zone function. And finally, there's universal plug and play support. So basically, if you are using some I don't know, personal cloud device or multimedia device or file server or Plex server or I don't know, anything with potential internet access. Basically, you should be able to enable this universal plug and play function, and it should work by default without any additional settings. But if it doesn't, I highly recommend using the virtual servers right here. Next, we have the USB settings. So this is my device. And we can set the sharing access. Either you are using the default administrator account for your router, or you can also choose to create another username with another password for accessing your external device. And then there's the media server name, the one you saw before. You can choose to enable the media server. You can choose to show your device in the network neighborhood. You can choose to enable or disable the FTP server. And you can manually select the port, of course. And you can also choose to enable or disable the FTP server via internet. Also, you can choose here as well to share all folders or only some of them, or you can enable and disable authentication like this. And the print server, of course, the same I showed you before. Then there's parental controls again. It seems I forgot to save after deleting the keywords before. So let's save it this time. It's the same functionality, so I'm not going to show it again. Then there's some bandwidth control, but this is actually pretty basic. You can only select the maximum upstream and downstream bandwidth. There's no priority functionality right here. You can choose some IP range and port range and the desired protocol, and choose some priority on a scale from 1 to 8. And the upstream and downstream bandwidth. But this is also pretty basic because you will have to set this for a certain IP or a certain port, so you won't be able to select different contents like I don't know, file transfers or multimedia or browsing. I mean, you can do that, but you must do it manually, and you have to know the port range for each and every app you are using. So this won't be that easy, but anyway, it's good it's here. Okay. Next, we have the security function. So the firewall is enabled by default. And we can also enable the DOS protection and some flood attack security as well. We can forbid LAN ping and WAN ping or not, depends on what we want to do. And we can also see right here the blocked DOS host list if we are going to use this. Okay. There's some access control as well. So we can choose to enable or disable certain devices. Like this, we need to know the MAC address and device name, and that's it. And we can blacklist or whitelist them. And we can also bind the IP and MAC address. Like this, MAC, IP, enable, and okay, and that's it. And here's the current list. IPv6 is by default disabled, but if you want to use it, of course, be my guest and enable it. So this is the part for the internet connectivity. And then there's the part for the local area network connectivity. Okay, I'm not going to use this. And finally, there's the system tools. So the first one is the time settings. And you can choose two different NTP servers so that your router would be constantly synchronized via internet. And you can choose to set your daylight saving schedule. You can also diagnose your router like this. So maybe you want to ping something. Let's start. Or maybe you want to trace route the signal. Okay, so this is taking a bit too long, so I'm going to just refresh the page. And let's go back to advanced. Next, there's the firmware upgrade utility. Unfortunately, there's no option to automatically check online for a firmware upgrade, so you will need to manually search, look on the TP-Link website, download the firmware, and then upload it to your router and hit upgrade. You can save your settings, save a file with your settings, or you can restore an old file containing your settings, and here you can restore to factory defaults. Here you can change the username, login username and password, and you can change the local management option and the remote management option. So you can actually enable remote management, and you can set up your router from outside your local area network. We also have a system log here, and we can filter it like this, and so I have no emergency and no alerts, no critical messages, and no errors. Only some notices and info. Okay. You can also enable simple network management protocol. Like this. And we also have a statistics page. This is for traffic statistics, like this. And finally, there are the system parameters. So we have the some more advanced settings for the wireless right here for each available radio interface. And finally, we can disable the VPS function completely. And now it's totally gone. And we can enable, we can choose a schedule for the LEDs, because probably some of you will be keeping the router pretty close to bed during night, and all those shining LEDs might be disturbing. So you can select your night time. Maybe you are going to bed at 22 o'clock, and you are getting back up at, I don't know, maybe 8 or so, and save. And during this night time, there won't be any light coming out of your router, but you won't be able to know if your router is on, if you have internet connectivity, and so on, unless you access this management interface. And next, there's the DOS protection setting here. And that's about all. There's also some language selector tool. So these are the available languages right here. I already showed you the help button. And there's some info in the footer of the screen, like the firmware version and the hardware version. And finally, a quick link to support page. Okay, but as you can see, this is a generic TP-Link support page. I'm going to log out now. Okay, just one more thing. I want to show you how fast the C3200 can reboot. Yes. Okay, so that seemed a bit slow at the beginning, but then it went much faster, as you could see. So I think it's pretty okay. So that's about all for today, guys. I'm going to log out now. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope this will be useful for you, and see you next time.